Good evening. Hallelujah. Good to see everybody tonight. Let's pray and get right into it. Father, we just thank you for your presence that is already in this room. And now we ask that the teacher, the Holy Spirit, would come in this room and help us to identify with Christ. That you would show us internally what we can experience in your kingdom. What we can experience through the dimension of the fullness of Christ. And we thank you for this understanding. Now illuminate us from the inside out. Reveal Christ on the inward parts, that he may dwell in our faith, in our hearts by faith, and that we, being rooted and grounded in love, may comprehend with all saints the length, the breadth, the height, the depth, the fullness of your riches. We ask this, Holy Spirit, acknowledging you in everything we do, everything we say. We want to hear through the filter of your presence. We want to see through the filter of your presence. We want to be able to exalt the kingdom of God in our lives above even our earthly dwelling. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. In agreement with that, shout amen. Hallelujah. God is good, isn't he? Hallelujah. I want to read this principle of warfare. You know, a lot of people are shouting about warfare, you know, and declarations about warfare, and we're gonna do this and we're gonna do that. And I sit and watch some things, and it's a lot of declaration and not a lot of doing. A lot of what we're going to do, but really the biggest war you're ever going to fight is the one between your chin and the top of your head. The biggest war you're ever going to fight is the one between your ears. That's the biggest war you're ever going to fight. You want to tear down a principality, start with the one that lives right above your eyeballs. Amen? Your brain. Your brain is the biggest principality you'll ever fight. Your soul will be the biggest mountain and the biggest giant you ever defeat. Amen? And, you know, we've got to learn this. I think you could spend a lifetime preaching identification in a local church. Because until you get the foundation of identification right, your Christian life is going to be like riding the beast at King's Island. That's a roller coaster. Amen? And it's going to be ups and downs and turns and twists. But when you get identification, that is the foundation of stability for a Christian life. Amen? And once you get that thing in you, it is a rock of Gibraltar. It's an anchor of hope. And it's like, no matter what circumstance comes against you, you can hold fast. Amen? Now, I love this verse, Deuteronomy 20, verse 1. We've been using this in this series, Killing the Giants in Your Soul. When you go out to battle against your enemies, you see horses and chariots and people more numerous than you. Do not be afraid of them. For the Lord your God is with you, who brought you up from the land of Egypt. So it shall be, when you are on the verge of battle, the priest shall approach and speak to the people, and he shall say to them, Hear, O Israel, today you are on the verge of battle with your enemies. Do not let your heart faint. Do not be afraid, and do not tremble or be terrified because of them. For the Lord your God is he who goes with you to fight for you against your enemies to save you. And just as Israel had to believe in an invisible God to go up against visible enemies, we have to believe that that same invisible God is in a cohabitation in our hearts. And we're trying to overpower and overcome a sin nature. Those giants in our soul, those giants of lying, stealing, those giants of lust and perversion, those giants of pride and arrogance, those giants of depression and shame, whether they're big giants or little squirrely giants, they're giants. And I'm telling you, it's the greatest battle you ever fight is just trying to keep a right attitude 24 hours a day. Trying to keep that attitude under control. Trying to keep the mind of Christ in you. Greatest battle you ever fight. And believe me, the enemy will make sure that you have all kinds of opportunities throughout your day to visit and to go back to the old identity. You know, I heard this in my when I was praying. Some folks are shacking up with their old man. Their old man, who they were before, they're shacking up with him. You know, we're not supposed to be shacking up with the old man. We're supposed to be divorced. We're supposed to be living with a new husband. His name is Jesus. We're supposed to be living with Christ in our hearts and that being full of glory. And man, it is the greatest battle you ever fight. Just battling off self-pity. Battling off, you know, these things that just pound us day in and day out. And in this culture of entitlement, you got these voices screaming out, you should have this and you should have that and you should have this and you should have that. In this culture, you know, he's got this and she's got that and you don't. Them voices, instead of just saying, you know what? I got the greatest treasure. I've got the greatest treasure that you could have on planet Earth. I've been born again. But if you're not identified in Christ, you'll still hold the treasures of this earth. You know, I go around some church cultures and everything's about a title. I'm so-and-so, and I'm so-and-so, and I'm so-and-so. Everything's about a title. Why? Because it's an identity. I'm trying to feel like I'm valuable. I'm trying to feel like I'm somebody. You go around the education, and you go around higher education. You get around postgraduate education. Everything's around a title. I mean, titles become idols in culture. I got one title I need, son. That's all I need, because as long as I'm son, that means I have father. And as long as he's my father, that means I'm his son. And there's no higher rank anywhere in the kingdom of God than to be a son or a daughter of the Most High God. That outranks generals. That outranks prime ministers. That outranks the President of the United States. That outranks every education degree. You can have more degrees than a thermometer, but if you're a son, you've risen to the height of full expectation from God, because this is the will of God concerning you, that you believe in His Son. And if we get that right, everything else just begins to fall into place. It's who I am, not what I do, that identifies me. Man, I got my identity so messed up in ministry when I was a young minister. I got my identity messed up. God had to separate me from my identity as a pastor. I mean, that was my identity. Who are you? Pastor Dave. What do you do? Pastor Dave. And one day, man, God just dealt with me. I'm driving down this street in Jackson, Ohio, called Huron Street. And I was right beside this building. We used to call it the welfare building because that's where all the humans, you know, the human resource center was in our city. I was right perpendicular to that building. And the power of God filled up my little black Nissan pickup. And the Lord said to me, you're my son and I'm proud of you. And I mean, it was like heaven came into my soul. And it was like instantaneously I was shown that I had lived in a false identity for several years as a pastor. And because of that false identity, my emotions were attached to my identity. So if the church attendance was up, I was up. If the church attendance was down, I was down. If Christians were acting right, I was up. If Christians were acting wrong, I was down. If I had good offerings that week, I was up. If I had bad offerings that week, I was down. Because everything in my identity was around my success as a church pastor. Well, that's a pretty tough identity when you're dealing with a bunch of crazy people. Hello? Have you met Mr. and Mrs. Christian America? Bunch of nuts. Not you guys. I'm talking about the rest of them people. Are you with me? You know what I'm talking about? You're dealing with fickle human beings and you're going to allow them to put an identity on you? And you know, oh, my identity is I'm a singer. Yeah, until someone hits a note you can't hit and then you're a failure. My identity is I'm this or that. There'll always be someone that can sing better, dance better, play better, smarter, better looking, taller, faster. There'll always be someone. And so anytime you get your identity in that, and man, I'll tell you what, when I got this whole identification thing wrapped up right in my heart, it changed my whole life. I mean, I started getting out of the roller coaster emotional responses that we've been talking about. Why? It don't matter if no one shows up. I know who I am and I know whose I am. I'm a son of the Most High God. And when you preach a message that the Bible tells you they're going to kill you for preaching, it's hard to get an identity from something that they hate. This ain't a popularity contest here. This is preaching the cross. This is preaching death. How to win friends and influence people. Follow me and die. Oh, that'll work. And stop doing everything you want to do. And only do what you don't want to do. That didn't make it in the book. How to win friends and influence people. Amen. Think about it. So God began to deal with me. And he began to say, tell me about this identity thing. Who I am and whose I am. All of a sudden it began to hit me. My God, my whole life has been what I do. And as soon as I began to shift that whole foundation into I'm a son of the Most High God. I'm not a pastor, I'm a son who pastors. I'm not even an apostle, I'm a son who has an apostolic mission in the earth. People say, who are you? I'm a doctor. No, you're a son that tries to help people get healed. Who are you? I'm this. I'm an engineer. No, you're a son that tries to help build things. You got to get that son thing right. You get your identity in a job, is all it takes is a pink slip to wreck your whole world. You get your identity in anything you do, is all it takes is someone to boo or hiss you, and you're a wreck. But once you're rooted in the Son, let me ask you, the Bible says death, nor life, nor principality, nor powers, things present, things to come, things past, nothing can separate us from the love of a father and a son. My kids can mess up a lot, but I still love them. They don't freak out every time they, you know, make a mistake, thinking dad's done with us. He's going to ask me to, you know, separate genetically. No. We're in this thing for life. Amen. We're in this thing for life. And so we're trying to conquer these giants. And man, when you go up against these giants that you spent a lifetime thinking you were this. You know, we had a teaching along this line one time. In fact, it was Kevin that was teaching on identity over in the Jackson Church. This was 25 years ago, and I'll never forget. There was a guy who came into the church, and he owned a business in town. And he visited the church. And that guy, when he heard the message of identity, the guy that brought him told me the next week, he had to go make an appointment with the psychiatrist. He was so messed up. He had spent his whole life thinking, and he was a musician. And he had spent his whole life in an identity as a musician, a muso. And because of that, when he found out that that didn't make him valuable, he was a wreck. He was a soul wreck. I mean, it was like everything he had spent his whole life, this is my value. It was like the rug was pulled out from under him. Because it only takes one thing to become valuable with God, and that is you believe in His Son. and you follow him. And so these big old giants are parading around in our soul, and these Philistines and these Jebusites and Hittites and Amorites, they're all in there and they're all screaming, you know, you're never going to beat me. That black dog of depression, you're never going to beat me. That green eye of envy, you're never going to beat me. And then we become rooted in the Son. Now, how do we activate this stuff? Go to Romans 5 with me. Romans 5. We talked the last time about Proverbs 12, anxiety in the heart causes depression. Well, when we got 25% of Americans taking some kind of a psychotropic drug to battle some kind of depression or anxiety, we got to know the cause so we can find the cure. And we can cover the symptom. And thank God, I mean, the drugs have kept people from committing suicide. Of course, sometimes they say if you take this, you may have suicidal thoughts. So we don't know which one's which sometimes. They're practicing, you know, medicine. They're practicing medicine. They don't know. They're practicing. I just saw, you know, today they got a new pill out, you know. It's amazing. They're practicing this stuff. They don't know for sure. In fact, if you go on YouTube and you do there's a video on there. It's about 90 minutes long, and the video is on the history of psychotropic medicine. If you watch that video, you'll go, wow. Because 40 years later, they don't know what works and what don't work. They just mix stuff up and give it to you and say, you feel better? And now we got to figure out what that causes. Your hair will fall out. You have leaky discharge. But you won't be depressed. You'll leave a brown stain everywhere you sit, but you won't be depressed. Your teeth will fall out. Your eyes will cross, but you'll feel good. Amen. I love them ones on TV. It says, may cause death. Oh, that's a great side effect right there. May cause death. That means I got to take it to find out. Think about it. So, believe me, man, these things, I will do everything in my power that I can do to stay away from putting chemicals in my body. Why? Because of the side effects. Because you fix one thing, you break another. If there's a cure, you know, when I found out I had the early stages of heart disease, I could have went down and got me some Relicor or whatever that's, you know, some Crestor. I could have got me some Crestor, and they tell you, yeah, you take this, and then guess what that does to you? And I could have, when I found out I was borderline diabetic, I could have went down and got me some, what's the pills you take for that stuff? But then if you do the research, they say, well, then you have to keep taking more and more and more and more and more, and it don't work then. So you got all these. Instead, I said, what causes this? And so as I went in and found the cause, I found out that the root of my disease came because of my blood chemistry. When I digest animal protein, it causes a thing called a homocysteine in my blood that burns my artery walls. And because I have a propensity to have a higher cholesterol level, and my blood has a propensity to have a higher triglyceride level, those chemicals, those bad fats, they plug up my arteries. And you say, well, I don't have low cholesterol. Then you'll probably fight cancer. Bet you didn't know about that study, did you? You know that if you don't have heart disease, there's a good chance you'll fight cancer. 50% of the population will fight heart disease, and the other 50% will usually fight cancer. They found out when you have low cholesterol, you're more susceptible to cancer. When you have high cholesterol, you don't usually get cancer, you get heart disease. My God, what do? Eat broccoli. You're healed. No, I'm just kidding. It does help, though. It helps. It made a big difference in my life. So I'm saying that on the natural side, find the cause instead of the cover-up. Because the cure is in the cause. Well, in the spiritual man, again, anxiety in the heart causes depression. Why do I just feel... Let's go back in time. And as we go back in time, we find out we've been anxious about something. We've been worrying. We've been stressing. When the Bible says, when you see these giants and these enemies, do not fear them. When you have that, those rumors, they're going to lay you off. Hey, you know what you do when you hear those rumors? The economy, they're going to raise interest rates. Oh my God, have you heard about what's supposed to happen this September? We're supposed to have an economic shutdown. My God, I'm going to go order from Jim Baker all my rapture material, and I'm going to get me a bunch of food and hide in my basement. I'm going to get me a solar generator and that food that lasts for 200 years, even though I'm only going to be alive another probably 30. I can sit around and freak out. I always say to the preppers, how many guns you going to get to stop a city from coming when they find out you got food and they don't? I was watching the preppers one day. I only saw one episode, and I couldn't stop laughing because this guy spent $1 million building a 2,000 square foot bomb shelter, and they were showing the front door to go down underground with so thick a steel they said a tank could hit it, and it wouldn't, a tank couldn't penetrate it. And then they showed on the back side of the little sand dune where this thing was built, there was a pipe sticking out of the ground that would about fit a 5-pound sack of potatoes, and that's where their air came from. Think about it. You can't knock down my door with a tank, but you can drop a sack of potatoes down, clog my vent up, and I'm going to smother. Come on, man. We can live in fear, or we can live in faith. And I'm not talking about being foolish and not preparing at all for anything, but I'm saying we can't be governed by anxiety and fear. We can't sit around and worry about, oh, I've heard young people say, I don't even want to bring another child into this world. Well, that's what your parents were thinking. Every generation thought Jesus was coming. Every generation thought, since Paul and Peter, they thought the Antichrist was alive. They thought Nero Caesar was the Antichrist. They knew Stalin, Hitler, Mussolini. These were all antichrists. And the Bible says many antichrists have gone into the world. And then they knew the antichrist when they brought that statue and they wanted to put that statue in the temple. They knew that was the abomination of desolations, that the end would come now. They knew it. Every generation has had to deal with the anxiety of the uncertain and the unknown, because God has determined that we must live by faith. We must live by faith. Faith of the Son of God. We must live by faith. We cannot be governed by fear. We've got to live like the children of Israel in the land of Goshen, knowing that God has reserved His wrath for the wicked, not for His sons and daughters. And should God pour wrath on the earth, He will provide us a land of Goshen. Whether it is an escape through a rapture or a hidden place, I don't know. But I know one thing. God said, I'll prepare a great eagle and to carry my people to safety. There is going to always be God taking care of His sons and daughters. God didn't save you to kill you. God saved you to save you. The wrath of God is reserved for the wicked. Amen. So we've got to deal with anxiety every day. Fear of the uncertain, the unknown. Cars breaking down. Furnaces breaking down. Air conditioners breaking down. Hot water tanks blowing up. Jobs laying off. Oil prices dropped. I was in a little town South Texas this week called Alice, Texas. And I was with this guy, and we're driving through Alice, Texas, and there were hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of acres of empty parking lots. And he said, these parking lots a year and a half ago were filled to capacity with cars. And I was talking to this one guy, and he said, I was at the hotel, and I said, how in the world did you end up in Alice, Texas? Where are you from? He said, I'm from Pittsburgh. I said, how'd you end up? He said, the oil fields. He said, one day we showed up for work and everything was great, and a guard met us at the gate and said, you got 10 minutes to go in and clean out your lockers and get all your stuff. We're done. Thousands and thousands of jobs were gone instantly without any warning. These good paying jobs, and these folks are, I mean, we live in uncertain times, and so therefore we've got to be certain about something. And the something we've got to be certain about is that our faith in God will sustain and keep us through anything. Now think, ask yourself this question. What did he do the last time I faced a crisis? Was he faithful then? He'll be faithful again. Oh, it might not have been comfortable, but he was faithful. It wasn't comfortable when we shared the other day about the Apostle Paul and how he said this messenger of Satan was sent to buffet me, and I begged God three times, get this devil off me. And God said, no, you need that devil. Keep you humble. My God, I had the Lord visit me one time in a manner like that. I was asking him for something great. And he came and said, I can't give you that. It'd kill you. I can't give you that. It'd kill you. You think you can handle it, but you couldn't. I know you better than you know yourself. And you got to remember this. Wherever you're at today, God will do better for you than you do for yourself. And God isn't going to leave you where you are today. There is a certain future. And your certain future may not involve a Lincoln Town Car. Well, I don't even know if they make those anymore. It may not involve a Beamer. It may not involve a Hummer. It may not involve a mansion. Except in heaven, where a thief can't steal it and the economy can't take it away. In heaven, where oil prices won't affect anything, and the stuff they worship called gold on earth will be your driveway. We won't have a driveway. It'll be a walkway, I guess. You ever wonder why they call a driveway and a parkway? A parkway? Why don't they call a driveway a parkway? That's where you park. And a parkway a driveway, because that's where you drive. Somebody got mixed up and they just left it that way. The world's full of crazy things, isn't it? It's uncertainties. Romans 5, did you find that yet? Therefore, since we are... Romans 5. That's where we were going. I haven't preached in a week. Excuse me. You can't tell, can you? People tell me, I believe I'm called to preach. I said, when's the last time you preached? Oh, 6 months ago. I said, you ain't called to preach. You was called to preach, you just told me at least yesterday. Why? Because it's a fire shut up in your bones. When you're called to preach, you're going to preach to somebody. Animal, human, painting. You're going to preach to a painting on the wall if you got to. You're going to preach to somebody. You're going to find a place to vent. Because like Jeremiah said, I'm like wine with no vent. I'm about to blow. I got to dump this on somebody. Amen. Therefore, since we are justified, I'm reading from the Amplified, acquitted, declared righteous, and given a right standing with God through faith. Through faith, not through works, of course. Not through perfectionism, not through some human standard of religion that, you know, you've been handed down through some tradition. If you're a Catholic, it's not because you said the rosary this morning. If you're a Pentecostal, it's not because you spoke in tongues today. If you're a Baptist, it's not because you witnessed today. If you're a Seventh-day Adventist, it's not because you went to church on Saturday. It's through faith. Now, you may have done all those things in response to faith, but we got to get to the cause. Jesus said, is there not a cause? David said, is there not a cause? There's a cause to getting whole in your soul. There's a cause. Justified, acquitted, declared righteous, given right standing with God through faith. Let us grasp the fact that we have peace, the peace of reconciliation to hold on and enjoy. Peace with God. My pastor always said it like this. He said, when the devil's thrown his best shot, and you just stand there with that silly believer's grin on your face, you will frustrate the hordes of hell. The devil's given everything he's got. He's delivered every piece of bad news that he could get to your address, and you just say, it is well. I've been singing that song for 2 days. It is well with my soul. I love that. Why? Because the winds and waves still know that name. Every knee still bows. Every demon still trembles at the name of Jesus. The rocks cry out if we become silent at the name and the presence of God. It is well. It is well. It is well. We've got to take that identity. Well, it is well. Well, you don't know. It is well. I've just been given a diagnosis of a terminal disease. Well, at least you know where you're going. Hey, you're not of those who don't have any hope. You know your destination is final. You may get there a few days earlier than you hoped. But praise God, I'd rather know where I'm going. And with that hope and with that faith, it becomes that anchor of my soul. It is well. It is well. Through Him, we also have our access, our interests, our introduction by faith into this grace, a state of God's favor in which we firmly and safely stand. How did those men rejoice in prison? How did Paul and Silas, while in the inner prison, the nasty part, we're talking nasty, feet in stocks. You ever try to go to the bathroom with your feet in stocks? Think about it. Beaten, backs striped with a cat of nine tails. At midnight, they began to sing praises to God, something like this. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It was that response of faith that shook the prison. It was that response of faith that brought the angelic deliverance. It's through faith that we stand against circumstances, against any news that comes our way. Against every adversary, we stand in faith. It is well with my soul. We have access how? Through Jesus.
Well, you're a pastor. You don't understand.
Listen, I'm a pastor right now. When I step off this platform, I'm Dave. I'm in an anointing right now that's just fearless. When I step down off there, I got to face the same demons you do. And then the bad thing is I got to face half of yours. Because they're mad because I encouraged you tonight. So I got to go home not only with my devils, I got to go home with your devils. The Bible says you smite the shepherd, you scatter the sheep. You don't have a greater grace to deal with warfare when you're in a position like this. You just have a gift to proclaim it. But you got to walk out of here, and my soul likes to tremble just like your soul likes to tremble. And I got to take hold. We used to have a statement back in the 80s when people would start having an emotional crisis, we'd say, take hold. And my wife would say, take ye hold. Take ye hold. Kyung, I can still remember her. Take ye hold. Take ye hold. My God, you ain't never seen a demon scream till you've had Kyung pray over you. Jesus. Come out, Jesus' name. Come out. I mean, this thing is, it's faith. The devil can't knock you out of your identity once you're set in it. Nothing can take it from you. The Bible says nothing shall take them from my hand.
Well, what about so-and-so? He walked away.
He walked away from God. No one took him out. He walked away. If you want to stand, God says, I'll stand with you. If you want to fight, God says, I'll fight with you. If you want to run, God says, run alone. I'm staying right here. You can walk away from God. God never walk away from you. You can walk away from God. As long as you follow Him, He'll be there. And we got to believe that. We've got to stand having done all, stand. Through him also we have this access, entrance, introduction by faith into this grace, the state of God's favor in which we firmly and safely stand. And let us rejoice and exalt in our hope of experiencing and enjoying glory of God. Glory of God. Moreover, let us also be full of joy now. See that exclamation mark? Now be full of joy. Let us exult and triumph in our troubles and rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that pressure and affliction and hardship produce patient, unswerving endurance. See, what you praying for God to deliver you from, he's delivered you to. And you praying for a breakthrough, and he's trying to give you a growth through. You're saying, God, set me free. And he says, fight for your freedom. Why? Because you're going to get stronger. And you may not know it, but you're just fighting a little Oompa Loompa devil right now. The big devils are about 5 years down the road. And if you can't whip Mickey Mouse and Minnie, God help you when Wile E. Coyote comes after you. Come on, somebody. God help you when the big devils come. If you can't run with the footmen, how will you contend with horses? If you faint in the day of adversity, Proverbs says your strength is small. How are you going to get stronger? You need some resistance. You need some resistance. You may not even know it. God may be sending little devils just to give you a spiritual workout. You may be fighting some devils and you don't even realize. You don't even realize the end result of this. And when that devil comes, and when you get the phone call, and you're sitting in Ruby Memorial. Was you in Ruby? Life flighted? When your husband's getting life flighted? Like, Donna, you're singing, "It Is Well." I was getting positive, encouraging texts. "It is well. We're going to get through this thing. God's, the doctors are saying this, but there's a higher physician that we're yet consulting. He's not yet spoken. It is well." And I don't know about you, but I've been praying for a spiritual awakening to happen through this whole situation. That's what I've been praying for, sister. I've been with you saying, "Oh, Father, it's time for some eyes to open up here. It's time to realize somebody's about to be met with mortality and say, now, wait a minute here. It is well, because all things are going to work together in this situation. It ain't over till it's over. It ain't over till it's over." Now, when I was a kid, they used to say, "Church ain't over till the fat lady sings." That's not politically correct today, so I won't say it. That's what they used to say when I was a kid. No church, though. Fat woman ain't got up yet. Amen? That woman, big mouth, she ain't got up yet. Don't text that. Don't tweet that. My God, you'll have me. You'll have anyway, moving right along. The PC police will be at the door in the morning. And endurance. Fortitude. Holy Ghost guts, fortitude, courage. What did God tell Joshua? Be strong and very courageous. Man, you've got to, what did God tell, what most, these Egyptians you see today, you'll see them no more. Amen. The impossible sea before you is your path of deliverance. And the defeat of your enemies. I mean, you just never know what God's up to. But I promise heaven's got a plan for your life. And heaven's working out a plan in your life. And when you seem most lost, Sometimes that's just God. He's just pulled back to make you find true north. But He's put a compass in your heart called the Holy Ghost. And sometimes we just don't know what we're doing. Sometimes we just don't know what we're doing. Man, I've learned through so many episodes in life, and even the last 7 days, I'm amazed at what God will do to help a human being. I'm amazed. God will move heaven and hell. God will move every mountain on the earth to help one of His children in need. He will. He's a good God. And I'm loved by Him. He's a good, good Father, as we sing. And we're loved by Him. Endurance, fortitude, develops maturity of character, approved faith, and tried integrity. Approved faith. Every once in a while, the Lord just allows something to happen, because sometimes you get to riding a little too high in the saddle. That's what they used to say in Texas. You get to riding a little too high in the saddle. You get a little puffy up, you know. You get a little puff head devil on you. You start thinking you the shining star. And I'll tell you what, I found out every once in a while, God will just say, you really think you're something? Watch this. And I mean, He don't even have to stick a big toe out to trip you. He can just let a little toenail hang out to trip you. And next thing you know, you're crying out to God saying, oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. And then He brings you back into reality and you realize, but by the grace of God, there go I. And anything I have is by the grace of God. Anything I am, it is by the grace of God. Anything given by faith, I stand in a grace. And what is the grace? A grace is an unmerited favor. A grace is a gift. Grace is an empowerment. Grace is an endowment. Grace has got as many facets as these little diamonds in my ring. Grace shines so many different colors through our lives. Grace gives us so much. And we stay in grace through faith. Faith is the voice that answers the voice. Faith is the voice that answers the voice. When the old preacher used to say, when the devil knocks at your door, just send Jesus to answer. Son of God, can I help you? I answer in Jesus' name. I answer in Jesus' name. We are not a people without hope, the Bible says. But we have a sure foundation. We have a sure destination. We know in whom we believe. We know in whom we trust. Whatever uncertainty you're facing or may face, you've got to send faith. You've got to send Jesus to answer it. This character of sort produces, look at this, guys, the habit of joyful and confident hope of eternal salvation. Sometimes when I'm having a really bad season, every once in a while I get one of them. How about you? Every once in a while I wake up and I just don't feel like a champion. Some days I wake up and feel more like a dartboard and the enemy's got a handful of darts. Some days I wake up and I literally, people have gotten on my last nerve. Oh yeah. There's days I make faith confessions. I have to make faith confessions. I have to say, I am not going to be moved by what I see. I am not going to be moved by what I hear. I'm only going to be moved by what I believe. Why? Because I have a hope of an eternal salvation. My salvation is not going to be determined by circumstantial, seasonal evidence. It's eternal. I'm going to die and I'm going to leave this body. I'm going to leave it behind and I'm going to forget everything that I ever feared. And I got to keep myself anchored in these things. And that gives me a habit of joyful and confident life. And everything inside me screaming out, I'm like, no, in Jesus' name, I stand, I stay. Why are you screaming, oh my soul? Hope in God. Didn't he deliver you the last time and the time before that? And when you thought there was no way out, he made a way of escape. And when you fell and thought there was no way back, he lifted you up out of the miry clay. And my God, when you thought I've committed the unpardonable sin, he showed you you've not even scratched his grace. You hadn't even put a dent in his mercy. When you thought you'd failed God that he could never use you again. And you were ready to throw in the towel on your own destiny. Hope came calling and said, you'd see nothing yet. Though a righteous man falls 7 times, surely he will rise again. My God, if he didn't give us grace for our screw-ups, none of us would even be here tonight. He didn't give us grace for a moment, an hour, a day, a week, a month, a year, a decade, a century. He gave us grace for a lifetime. And by grace we stand. And in faith we stand. And this grace is not a get out of jail or get out of hell free card. It's not basically a license to live licentiously. This grace is an empowerment to resist. And should I fall, I will confess and stand in grace again. Should I screw up, I will stand and rise and fight again. That's what this grace does for us. This perverted grace that's being preached today, it's a perversion of the gospel. My God, they need to read the rest of the book. The proof texting, exhorting preachers today, I mean, they need to get back and they need to understand that's not what grace is. Jesus said the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which I hate. That was the doctrine of extreme grace. It was started by the deacon who was chosen in the book of Acts who went rogue off God. That was the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, and twice Jesus said, I hate that doctrine. It was a doctrine that you could sin so grace could abound. You could sin and God would just give you more grace. And these people began to go back in and live immoral lives. And Nicholas taught them that. And that's why it was called the Nicolaitans. They were followers of Nicholas. But you know what? That same perverted doctrine is through this nation today, through the churches today, to a point if you can't even stand up and call sin, sin without having people get up and walk out of your service. You can't even call evil, evil, and good, good without having some disturbed. It's like the political correctness has come into doctrine now. We're not allowed to call evil, evil anymore. No. We got to stand, having done all to stand. We're going to use grace the way grace was designed to be used, not as a license to sin. Amen. Father, tonight I just pray over this house and over this people and over this congregation, over the homes and the families represented here. And Lord, I just thank you that through grace and through this faith, we are going to stand and we're going to beat the giants in our soul. We're going to overcome adversity. We're going to overcome emotional adversity. We're going to overcome situational adversity. We're going to overcome relational adversity. We're going to overcome physical adversity. We're going to overcome economic adversity. We're going to overcome spiritual adversity. We're going to overcome every adversity by faith. Through this grace that we stand in every day. And Lord, I pray that your people would be encouraged and exhorted tonight to fight the good fight of faith and lay hold of eternal life and let go of this temporal life. Thank you, Father, tonight. Holy Spirit, fill and charge every heart in this room. Let him know that with God all things are possible. and all things are possible to him who believes. I pray that every heart in this room would be filled with faith in the knowledge of the Son of God. I pray that every heart in this room would stand fast and be steadfast, immovable in the ways of God. Having done all, the Scripture says, stand and withstand in the evil day. This we do in Jesus' name. Stand with me tonight. Get my prayer team up here tonight. Father, we just pray over our children as they go back into the school year, and our youth, our college students. Lord, they're going into hell's gates when they go into these institutions. Higher education has become higher indoctrination. And I pray, Lord, that you would help our children to stand strong and to stand fast against the pressures of their peers and their friends. I pray that you would give them strength to say no, that they would choose their friends carefully, and they would not be led away after the wicked. I pray that they'll continue to see light and darkness, good and evil, lies and truth. And I pray that the anointing of truth will be in their hearts. And as we send our children out into life, I pray that the anointing, that unction that abides within them that John spoke of and said, you don't even have to have a man tell you, because that Holy One that's inside you will tell you right from wrong and good from evil. Lord, I pray that unction over our children. And I pray that they would stay filled with the fullness of God in this school year. And I pray that you'd give us divine strategies of reaching our communities. And I thank you that we've got access into your grace and boldness to stand in this day. We pray this in Jesus' name. If you need special prayer for anything tonight, we want to pray with you before you go. Thank you so much for coming out. We love you and bless you. We're going to see a great move of God. A great move of God this year again. Amen. Hallelujah.